In the previous video, we discussed how our dietary habits have changed over the last 12,000 years. We, the humans, got a lot of benefits from the introduction of grains, sugars, milk and dairy products, refined vegetable oils, fatty domestic meats, salt and alcohol. Again, 71% of calories we consume today come from the foods that did not exist 12,000 years ago. As you can guess, we also got some health problems, since there's a drastic and fast change on the evolutionary scale. Key health problems come from overeating. Today we have basically unlimited access to food. Life is like a big all-you-can-eat buffet. Low mineral, vitamin and fiber content due to consumption of refined grains and refined sugar as well as heat cooking. Shift from proteins to carbs. Shift from monounsaturated and polyunsaturated fatty acids to saturated fatty acids. Overconsumption of salt and finally alcohol. As a result, obesity, diabetes, hypertension, strokes, heart attacks, and various types of cancers and many other health problems become a part of life of our society. And you'll see that most, if not all, modern diets are trying to undo these trends to make us eat as healthy as human did 12,000 years ago. Hi, Andrey here. Welcome to the Practical Health Channel. What was the first diet in history? Historians state that the first well-shaped diets came around with the spreading of religion, which heavily condemned overeating. Christians even went as far as making gluttony a cardinal sin, punishable by eternal suffering after death. No one wants to be obese, but maybe eternal suffering is a bit harsh for overeating. The first diet book and cookbook appeared in Italy in 1474 AD, when paper technology evolved. Bartolomeo Sacchi wrote a book that balanced the pleasure of eating with the individual's health. The oldest, still circulating and still cited book on dieting is How to Live 100 Years or Discourses on the Sober Life by Luigi Carnara, published in 1558. Luigi advocated for less is more and went on to live his predicted 100 years he was so passionately wrote about. That's insane for the 16th century. Considering the life expectancy was only 35 years. That's like living for 240 years today. In modern times, one of the first dietitians was English Dr. George Chain. He himself was tremendously overweight and would constantly eat large quantities of rich food. He began a meatless diet, eating only vegetables and drinking milk, and soon lost excessive weight. He is the pioneer of lacto-vegetarian diets, and publicly recommended his diet to everyone suffering from obesity. In 1724, about 300 years ago, George wrote an essay of health and long life, in which he advises exercise and fresh air, and avoiding luxury foods. It sounds like a common sense now, but people in 1724 were in the dark about a whole bunch of things. In 1863, the English undertaker William Bentinck wrote a booklet called Let on Carpulence Address to the Public, which contained the specific plan for the diet he successfully followed. His own diet was 4 meals per day, consisting of meat, greens, fruits and dry wine. The emphasis of his diet was to avoiding sugar, sweet foods, starch, beer, milk and butter. He is considered to be the first to create a diet consisting of carbohydrate restriction. Bentinck's pamphlet was so popular that the question "Do you bend?" referred to his method and eventually to dieting in general. You still can buy a paper version of his booklet on Amazon. Bentinck was the first popular diet, and William Bentinck established the modern dieting trends that still last today. Basically, using today's terms, William Bentinck was the mega influencer in the dieting world. I bet he would be crushing it on TikTok. And quite recently, in 1918, just 100 years ago, an American physician and columnist, Lulu Hunt Peters, published the first best-selling weight loss book to promote calorie counting, called Diet and Health with Key to the Calories. Not the best title, Lulu, but hey, it sold phenomenally. Since that time, it's estimated that over 1,000 various diets have been developed. Wow, 1,000 diets! Each diet claims to be unique and unparalleled. But after reading about all these diets over and over, I realized that we could put most diets in one of 7 categories. Just 7. We'll talk about each category in detail, so it will be easier for us to navigate through them moving forward. The first category is belief-based diets. Some people's dietary choices are influenced by their religious, spiritual, or philosophical beliefs. The most known beliefs-based diets include Hindu and Jain diets. The followers of Hinduism and Jainism may follow lacto-vegetarian diets, based on the principle of Ahimsa, an ancient Indian principle of non-violence, which applies to all living beings. While the weight of followers of this diet is normal, papers revealed a high deficiency in nutrients such as calcium, proteins, and fibers, with the exception of iron, which is elevated due to the high consumption of greens. Another example is Islamic dietary laws. Muslims follow a diet consisting solely of food that is halal, permissible in Islam. Intermittent fasting is another practice which Muslims have applied for centuries, with demonstrated benefits to their cardiovascular system, lowering cholesterol, decreasing chance of obesity and type 2 diabetes, cancer prevention, and reducing the oxidative stress of our working cells. The highest form of intermittent fasting is the Ramadan, which has been demonstrated to have positive effects for the healthy, but can damage the health of those with prior illnesses. The next one is kosher diet, the food permissible under Kashrut, the set of Jewish dietary laws. It was not demonstrated to impact health in a positive or negative way. However, since it uses a lot of salt, those suffering of cardiovascular disease should be careful around this one. Other belief-based diets include Buddhist diet, which combines intermittent fasting with vegetarianism, ITAL, which is strictly vegetarian, Seventh-day Adventist, with restriction of alcohol and tobacco, with obvious positive effects. You probably don't need a special diet to know that tobacco and alcohol are bad for you. And there are many other less restrictive diets, such as the Christian diet. The next type of diets are diets followed for medical reasons. People's dietary choices are sometimes affected by their health needs, intolerance, or allergies to certain types of food. A good example of such diets is DASH diet. DASH stands for Dietary Approaches to Stop Hypertension. It doesn't stand for Dinner Always Slaps Hard. The DASH diet recommends that those with high blood pressure consume large quantities of fruits, vegetables, whole grains, and low-fat dairy products as part of their diet, and avoid sugar, sweetened food, red meat, and fats. If you have hypertension, DASH has been proven to lower the systolic pressure by an average of 5.5 millimeters of mercury. Combine that with exercise, quitting smoking, and good sleep, and it will further reduce the systolic pressure, even to normal levels, without medication. All scientifically proven. Other examples of this type of diet include the diabetic diet, gluten-free diet, ketogenic diet, and others. Number 3 is vegetarian diets. As the name implies, a vegetarian diet is one which excludes meat. Many people choose to abstain from food from animal sources to varying degrees. So vegetarian diets vary quite a lot. And its strongest form is veganism, the complete abstention from meat or byproducts of animal slaughter. Weight-wise, this diet definitely helps you cut down excessive pounds, but you might feel consequences of micronutrient deficiency down the line. The next type is detox diets. Detox diets involve either not consuming or attempting to flush out substances that are considered unhealthy or harmful. Examples include restricting consumption of food without colorings or preservatives, taking supplements, or drinking large amounts of water. Juice fasting is a good example of a detox diet. There is no solid evidence that detox diets are beneficial for one's health. However, it may possibly impact the mental status of one undergoing such diet, since it has a purification attraction to it. Now let's talk about diets that are really popular these days. And I want to say that the boundaries among the next three categories of diets are quite blurry. So, the fifth type of diets is weight control diets. A desire to lose weight or to maintain an existing weight is a common motivation to change dietary habits. This type of diet includes several subcategories, such as low-calorie diets, meaning 1,000 to 1,200 calories per day. Examples are Weight Watchers and Nutrisystem. Very low-calorie diets, 800 calories or less per day, such as Key Diet. Low-carbohydrate diets, such as Atkins Diet and South Beach Diet. And low-fat diets, such as McDougall's Starch Diet. Number 6 is the Crash Diets category. This is the weight control diets used for the purpose of very fast weight loss. These are the diets that are very popular on internet these days. They describe diet plans that involve making extreme, rapid changes to food consumption, but are also used as disparaging terms for common eating habits, which are considered unhealthy. Examples of these diets include the Beverly Hills diet, grapefruit diet, and others. Literature reveals that cases of psychological disturbances occur frequently after such diets, some even requiring hospitalization. An example being excessive and addictive drinking or potomania. And the last one, probably the biggest group of diets, is fad diets. A fad diet is a diet that is popular for a time, similar to fads and fashion, without being a standard dietary recommendation. Fad diets often promise unreasonably fast weight loss or nonsensical health improvements. Generally, fad diets promise short-term changes with little efforts, and thus may lack educating consumers about the whole diet and all of the lifestyle changes necessary for the sustainable health benefits. Examples of this diet, of this type of diet, includes alkaline diet, rice diet, 5-2 diet, and many others. I'm still waiting for someone to start the 100% chocolate diet. Since the fat qualification varies over time and depends on social and cultural views, this list is quite subjective. By the way, fad diet can stop being a fad and become a mainstream diet. This is what happened to the Mediterranean diet, which became one of the highest rated diets in the world right now. On the top of these 7 categories, as you can imagine, there are some other diets that don't really fit in any of these categories. Let me give you a couple examples. Low sodium diet, low sulfur diet, Okinawa diet, organic food diet, and many others. I read a lot about these diets and found my favorite one. It's anedia or breatharianism. This diet requires no food at all and is based on the belief that it's possible for a person to live without consuming food, and in some cases even water. It's considered a daily pseudoscience by scientists and medical professionals, and several followers of this practice have died from starvation or dehydration. To which I say, duh. So that's it for today. Let's sum up what we talked about today. The first diet dates back to the 15th century, and the oldest book on diets still circulating on the market. Today we have a thousand of diets and nutrition plans, each with their own benefits and downsides. Broadly speaking, there are 7 diet categories. Diets should be adjusted to the lifestyle and condition of the individual, so choose carefully. Next week we'll start talking in detail about the most popular diets, and we'll start with the paleo, vegetarian, vegan, and others. See you next week. Bye.